Good morning. The next land utilization along with water in the civil engineering practice, a major transportation system known as the port and harbor structures or dock and harbor structures. Comes in ocean engineering. A lot of civil engineering activities are to be performed before the evolution or realization of the port and harbor. This is the fourth transportation system which we are discussing. There's a similarity among all these four at the terminal points. In the terminal stations, you have a pair of components which are same. It will be interesting to note that. If you take the highway, a bus terminal, you need a bus bay where the incoming and the outgoing buses will be controlled, will be allowed to stay for a while, take the passengers, go, come in, leave the passengers, stay for a while, do the process. So the buses which are going to ply within minutes will come to the nearest to the terminal and do these procedures. The buses will, those who are going to start only at a later stage, will have their spaces little beyond the terminal. So buses coming, waiting, just like queue, waiting, coming to the bus base, taking the passengers or leaving the passengers, going or coming. So bus bay with layout for the buses to negotiate this process. Attached to that, you will have a governing system with complexes, control systems, which is a terminal building. That is the bus terminal. Similarly, in the railway terminals also, you have a railway station, a controlling, then a platform, then the stock rails, series of stock rails. So, rail, to accommodate the rails, to accommodate the goods and passengers, and to control the system. So, in railway station also, the components are alike to the previous. In the airport also, you have seen that you have a terminal building and an airfield, runway, taxiway, apron, guard, control towers, then the terminal building. So the terminal building and the airfields are attached. So the controlling, the management, monitoring, maintenance, everything synchronized and taking place smoothly. Same thing is the case with the port and harbor structures also. So we have seen land transportations in road and rail, air transportation, transportation over air by flights, aircrafts, now the water transportation. So deep seas, oceans, seas, so ships, boats, ferries, so they travel across. So there should be some berthing places, stopping places comfortably for the ships to come and take as a rescue, as a shelter, and load or unload the cargo or the goods. Then take the passengers in or leave the passengers out, embark or debark or de-embark. So for this process, this activities to take place, there should be a structure, an evolved structure near the shore and that part of the terminal is known as the port, corresponding to the terminal buildings in all other things, and the place where you have the vessels, ships, to come and get rescued or shelter or get anchored, is called a harbor. So harbor is analogous to the airfield or bus bay or the railway line. Port is relevant to the bus station or the railway station or the terminal, air terminal. So port and harbor. So the components are alike. The harbors are classified into three. One is natural harbors. By nature itself, there will be the harbor will be evolved. Semi-natural. It is some portion of the harbor has to be built, man-made. And the third is purely man-made, artificial harbor. So natural harbor, semi-natural harbor, and artificial. So once you know what harbor is, now you know what the role of the harbor. So there should be that the nature of that harbor site should be in such a way that there should be sufficient space for the ships to get accommodated with sufficient depth of water with the least interference of high velocity of wind and velocity of flow, and to take care of the tides, the deep winds, so on and so forth. So harbor sites, you should get a portion, an isolated, confined portion where the water will be almost still. The ships can come, get anchored, leave the goods, take the goods, go. So, as you have components on these terminals, what are the components in port and harbor structures? First is nothing but the port, the dock, then the harbor. This harbor, the confinement of this harbor is done by breakwaters. So first thing is the breakwater or moor, M-O-O-R, moor or breakwater. It will provide an opening, it will confine the whole water over an area, and ships will enter through the opening. So we'll have a breakwater or moor. So one component is nothing but the breakwaters. Breakwaters is to isolate or separate the deep sea and the shore water. Then you have the deck or the platform, which is known as the jetty. You would have heard about in Cochin, you would have a boat jetty. So that the magnitude, the volume or the area of the jetty increases corresponding to the type of the harbor, the nature of the harbor, the type of handling, cargo handling or passenger handling. Accordingly, the jetty, usually jetties will be small in size, but there are jetties which are larger in size too. So jetty, then the port, then the breakwaters, then you have the dry dock. Dry dock will be little away from that port. To facilitate, it will be in the shore, you will be just digging to a depth with a gate. It will have a gate. So water can enter and get filled. And once you remove, open the gate, water will get discharged. So that is called the dry dock. The purpose of the dry dock is to service the ships, fuel the ships, maintain the ships, station the ships, all those things. So ship or the vessel care center is a dry dock. So during tide, water will come and enter tide. So when in the absence of the tide, there will not be water. So you just open the gate, get the water, close the gate. So the required amount of water will come. Because of the buoyancy, the ship will come and you can have the operations. So dry dock is the place where the vehicles or even the containers, the things, the objects to be transported to the ship will come in the dry dock, and from the dry dock through a rail or a road it will be taken to the main port. So main port, just like the taxiway and the runway, you can consider analogous to a taxiway and runway. This dry dock is a place where you just take, but here the ships, main ships, may not come always to the dry dock. Always they may not come. But the containers, the cargo will come to the dry dock and they will be taken care of after the maintenance or servicing. Or even the containers which are sealed for the ship transportation, they will be taken through a road or a rail and they will be allowed to enter the harbor, main harbor. So dry dock. Then you have a lighthouse at each end of the thing, which is known as the pier. Piers are nothing but the platforms, huge piers, long and wide piers, separating each bay known as the basin, water basin, where the ships will get anchored. So these piers, at the end of the piers, you have the lighthouses. You have the lighthouses. And the piers facilitate passengers to get in or come out to act as a platform. So deep piers should have very deep pile foundations underneath the ground, the shore. So you will have pile foundation dug into the soil, then the pier will be constructed. So between two piers you have a water basin. That water basin will be utilized for the purpose of the ship to stay, take the cargo or passengers, leave the cargo or passengers. So the pier is one component, breakwaters another component, dry dock, then the main harbor, the port, then comes the quay, Q-U-A-Y, quay or wharf. Quay wall or wharf. They are the barriers. So breakwaters are at the front. Quay walls or wharfs encompasses. You need a closed confinement with an opening for facilitating the ship to enter or go out. So the back portions near the shore, the huge vertical element, is called wharf or quay wall. So wharf or quay wall, breakwater, they are continuous. Breakwaters, wharf or quay. Then you have the platforms, the jetties. Then you have the piers. Then the basins. Basins for facilitating the entry of ship. Then the ships have to turn and go for turning basins. Their turning basins have to be a little wider. Then only they can take a turning basins. As you have turntable in railways, here you have turn basins where the ships will be changing their directions. Turn basins. So turn basins, wharf or quay wall, jetties, piers, breakwaters, port, then the dry docks. Right? Now the purpose of the harbors. First purpose of the harbor is container terminals. To take the containers. The containers will come either by railways or by highways or even by air sometimes. Then they will be lifted using cranes and they will be kept in position by forklifts. forklifts and cranes will be used to take out the containers from the ship as well as put containers into the ship. So those terminals are called container terminal. Then for passengers, it is called cruise terminal, C-R-U-I-C-E, cruise terminals. Container terminals, if it is handling more bulk quantities of cargo, then it is called a bulk terminal. So container terminal, then the cruise terminal, then the fishing terminal. Fishing terminal, the product you get from the sea, fish products, as a trade of the fish, commerce of the fish, trading of the fish, and transportation of the fish. So fishing terminal. Then the naval terminal for military purposes, for defense. Naval terminal. So naval terminal, container terminal, fishing terminal, and cruise terminal. So these terminals, they may be apportioned on the same port and harbor. On the same port and harbor, you have allocations for these things, integrated, a large integrated system accommodating all these things. And that is called the layout of a port and harbor structure. So layout of a port and harbor structure, as you have a layout for the airport, you will have layout for bus terminal, you have layout for air, rail terminals, for air terminals, you have a layout for. So the planning of this layout of this air terminal and the port and harbor terminal also is very important while selecting a site for the port and harbor, taking into account, as you have seen, the temperature, the rainfall, the velocity of wind, the neighboring vicinity, an adjacent town which is capable of handling the containers, the transportation, land transportation facility. All those things will be taken into account, and the ship, the back side of the ship is called the stern, the front side is called the bow. Sometimes you usually lift on, lift off. That's the usual system. Put the cargoes inside using the crane and forklift, take out the cargoes using lift and forklift. The crane and forklift. But there is another system, it's roll on and roll off. So in roll on and roll off, if such as cars, jeeps, vehicles which are coming in the ship, they have their own wheels, so they can roll off and roll on. They can enter the ship by rolling on. So you need a ramp facility, usually from to the back or side or even bow of the ship, they will enter or come out. For which you need another component as a ramp component, which is required to link these vehicles coming at the port to enter the ship. So the link of the port and the ship entry is known as the link span. So it's just like a ramp, so that the vehicles can roll on and enter the, just like vehicles entering a workshop or a service station. And that component is, these are all structural components. They have to be designed because they are going to be constructed on water. So the sufficient foundations, by confining the water, making the water empty there, by constructing coffer dams. The coffer dams are the dams, a temporary dams constructed to drain off water by which you can drive the piles inside. Once a number of group of piles connected together with a cap, then once you have erected the foundation, the rest component superstructure can be constructed. So these are all have to be structurally designed. The port has to be structurally designed with the all hydraulic details, hydraulic wind action, wave action, ice pressure, earthquake to a great extent. All those things you have to take into account by taking and designing the port, the dock, the pier, the quay walls, and even the breakwaters. So these are all the civil engineering aspects during the realization of the project. Once these are all over, then it comes only the question of maintenance. But to start the any project of these, all these projects, highway, railway, airport and dock, all these projects require large land space, and in the initial stages, the role of a civil engineer plays a very vital role to realize the structure to its performance. Then the rest of the thing is only the maintenance of these components by a civil engineer. So this land, roads and railway, air, airport engineering, and the port and harbor engineering, port and harbor engineering, are all related civil engineering activities, have been told in a nutshell as an introduction, as a highlight for a readers to motivate. I don't know whether the reader has been motivated or not. Anyway, my purpose was that, to motivate a person, go deep into these subjects, and all these comprise this highway engineering, railway engineering, airport engineering, and port and harbor engineering, or dock and harbor engineering, or all the branches of civil engineering put in one term known as transportation engineering. So we are winding up transportation engineering today, which is the mainstream, one of the main streams in the civil engineering study. Usually there will be two courses on transportation engineering 1 and 2. In transportation 1, the highway engineering will be dealt in detail, and in transportation engineering 2, the railway, airport, and the docks and harbor will be dealt with. So transportation engineering is the branch of civil engineering which deals with transportation systems, planning, construction, management, maintenance, and control. You have B.Tech degree, then you will have advanced transportation systems as electives. Transportation systems as elective. But transportation engineering 1 and 2 are core subjects in civil engineering in B.Tech. Then you have M.S. or M.Tech in transportation engineering, including the sophisticated instrumentations, the traffic engineering, the automation of transportation systems, the geographical information systems, so on forth, so forth. So there are extensive studies in depth on M.Tech or M.S. of transportation engineering, and you have transportation engineering research. Lot of research is going on, structural design of pavements, types of highways, transportation systems, traffic engineering, different types of road surfaces, types of highway materials and their performance and service. So it's a very important and very flourishing and very developing field or branch of civil engineering. And the students who are pursuing transportation will have their jobs on either highway, railways, airport, or docks and harbor engineering as design engineers or operation managers or maintenance engineers or planners. And in Indian context, I have told you PWD, roads and bridges. Similarly, railways, you have the Railway Recruitment Board. Then you have the IES, Indian Engineering Service. Indian Engineering Service, similar to IAS and IFS. The central government engineering jobs, Union Public Service Commission, that you have Indian Engineering Service, it's very competitive examinations. Engineers are selected for central engineering projects from IES. So we wind up one major stream of civil engineering practice on land. Took more time today because one part we will finish today. Tomorrow we will take another mainstream of land utilization in civil engineering. Very mainstream. Thank you very much, Professor.